Today, my guest is a true Renaissance man. He owns an award-winning brand management and strategy consulting agency. He's worked with brands like Ferrari, Maserati, Miller Coors, Lincoln, and Disney, to name a few. And guess what, guys? He's an activist and philanthropist, currently serving with the Hosea Feed the Hungry and Homeless Foundation. And we got him right here today. He's talking what it means to be a Renaissance man and the purpose algorithm. You guys don't want to miss it. It's going down right now, and we got him one-on-one. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Daniel Dickey. And the crowd goes wild. Hey, how you doing, man?
I am good. How you doing, King?
Man, I'm good. I'm good. What you been up to? It's been a long time. I remember we last did the 2009 BET Awards.
Man, listen. Man, that was, look, wow, 2009, like 12 years ago. Yes. Yeah, that has been a long time.
A very long time.
I've been active, King. I decided to take the word busy out of my vocabulary about 5 years ago.
Okay.
Because when I think about the word busy now, I usually it doesn't have good PR. I think the word busy is like people lie for or excuse for why they didn't do something they said they were going to do. I think it's condescending. And I think that a lot of times when you look at people that say that they're busy, they're not usually doing anything that aligns with their purpose.
Got it.
So just your trash truck delivery and your poker games, you're consumed. Got it. No time to check in with friends, family, nobody. You got it.
That crazy part, man. It's so funny that when you talk to today's man or woman, their idea of busy is they got a lot of activity but no productivity.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So yeah, no. So I'm active and shooting a good percentage. That's what I'm up to right now. Active and shooting a good percentage. I have my past two videos on my IG are like basketball related. Uh-huh. One was me, you know, hitting a little bong, 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 turnaround three situation. And then I got the one I posted today is, Trae Young did the little shoulder shimmy in the game. I did that 3 or 4 years ago, Finch. You know what I'm saying? Like, just like, man, Trey, this is my young Padawan, you know, the millennial whisperer. Had to get Trey, show him how to get that done. You know what I'm saying?
That is funny, man. When you talk about people busy and, you know, just doing a bunch of nothing, that brings us to something you created called the purpose algorithm. You have to tell us about what that is and how that came about.
So the purpose algorithm is something that I came up with because I talk to a lot of people all the time. I'm, you know, talking to high school students, middle school students, college students. Mm-hmm. I even actually during COVID, I spoke to an elementary school, which was interesting, but it was cool. But, as people come into, as they're coming into that phase of coming into their adulthood and that boys to men, that girl to woman cycle. And in that mm-hmm. process, they're, and even now, you know, when you see people in their 20s and 30s and they're still struggling with how mm-hmm. how to uncover their purpose, like why they were put on earth, why they're here. Mm-hmm. And I think they make it this deep thing where they're waiting on God to be like, it is me. You know what I'm saying? Like, it is me. You're supposed to be a long hair person. You know what I'm saying? And so I feel like that wasn't valuable. And I think that wasn't fruitful. And I didn't think that when I look at my life, when I go back and look at my life and my adventures and all the things that I've been up to, one of the things that I was able to discover really quickly was I wasn't able to unlock my purpose until I did the following. And this is the purpose algorithm. And the first part of the purpose algorithm is helping others. Mm. Okay. So helping others plus your unique gifts, skills, and abilities equal your purpose. Simple stuff. Mm. Helping others is where it begins, and that's why people aren't close to their purpose, because we've exalted being selfish. We've made that be a trending topic and a thing that people would actually even pride themselves on, even though being selfish is a distraction from purpose, and it's a distraction from love. So helping others plus your unique gifts, skills, and abilities equal your purpose. So there won't be any miraculous voice. That won't ever happen. But if you put yourself into a position to where you help others with the things that you are uniquely gifted, qualified, and skilled to do, you will absolutely be on a path to your purpose.
So looking at, because you're absolutely right, when people think about being on their grind and hustling, they're thinking about things that they do, because the vast majority of people believe, although this is a falsehood, they believe they can make it in this life on their own with no help from anybody else. And I think that's ridiculous, for one.
Well, yeah, it's ridiculous, but it's also not true, because at the end of the day, like, if, you know, to just go all the way to the inception, if two people didn't decide to have sex on that specific day, at that specific time, then hello, you wouldn't even be here. So there's no by yourself. That's only a fool's goal. Because here it is. We work in a capitalistic, and we live in a capitalistic culture. So no matter what you're doing, somebody has, you got to be able to sell something, and people got to be able to buy something. Okay. And so unless you're selling your own products to yourself, or your own services to yourself, you know what I'm saying? Your own book to yourself, your own whatever, unless you're buying these things that you're also producing, creating, then obviously you're not doing anything by yourself. That's like, that's another fool's gold mission to me. Like nobody's doing anything by themselves. Nobody's self-taught. You had to watch somebody do it. Hey. Whether you watched on Instagram, whether you watched in real life, nobody's self-taught. Nobody did anything by themselves.
Man, that's a, you are speaking the truth, because you got to sell hella books to yourself.
Hella. For you to be a bestseller, for you to get to the bag where you retire at 30 and all that other cool stuff. Yeah. Yeah. I think people just say and do things now because they sound cool and they aren't necessarily, again, reconciling with their specific purpose or with anything that even brings value to our community. One of my pastors, Olu Brown, he talked about this around purpose and stuff like that. And he was like, his prayer for us is that we don't do things that we can do and not do the things that we were born to do.
True.
We were taught to focus on trades and stuff like that, but that don't really align with our hearts or our passions or our purpose. And so that's a big one there too.
Now, I was going to ask where you think that mindset come from, but I already know the answer, because when you think about us as people in general, we are programmed from inception to have a certain type of mindset. And it is a mindset that doesn't necessarily allow us to operate or even discover purpose.
Facts.
Because it teaches you to work within a system. Now, I'm going to probably get in trouble about this, but I'm fine, so I don't give a damn.
Okay, gotcha.
But when you think about this, we're born, right?
Facts.
And we are put into a system. We're given a ID number so that we can be tracked in our entire lives, right? That's what they call a social security number.
Right.
And so then the system has created so that we have to go to, well, we have to be taught by trained officials, so to speak. But they're teaching you a certain type of curriculum to get you to operate in a certain mindset that allows you to work in the industries in which they can make money off you. And we call that, back in the day, in our time, you and I, because we're the same color, slavery, right?
Got it. Facts.
So we put it in a nice little bow and we make it appear to be something that it's actually not. So when you come around and you talk to people like yourself, a Renaissance man, and you say, well, wait a minute, who does this guy think he is? He's talking about this, he's talking about that. Purpose, algorithm, that's mumbo jumbo, right? But really, when you think about it, you're someone like a small number of people who have independent thinking. Even though we've all born in a system, you don't have to stay in the system, right?
Right, right. And then the more you learn about the system, you understand that, again, these are all of the ways that they dumb us down. Like, that these are all the ways that they dumb us down. These are all the ways that they make us small. And they really just kind of put us into a hamster wheel, into a space where we're really just going to fight for a piece of a piece of a piece of a piece of pie with our own brothers and sisters, and see nothing wrong with it, see nothing illogical about it, and don't think anything needs to be unlearned. I think that Black people in America need to do more unlearning than they need to do learning. Like, honestly, because we are Renaissance people. You know what I'm saying? We don't come from simple people. We come from the people who created every fucking thing. You know what I'm saying? Like, yes. you know what I'm saying? So this whole simple, I was relatively appalled, but not surprised when I saw, did you see, Finch, where when they were doing the concussion stuff with the NFL athletes and they had a barometer and where they were able to base mental aptitude and all that kind of stuff like that. And they had Black people lower on the thing. So like basically like our brain function wasn't all that high in the first place. So when it's reduced because of concussions, it like doesn't really even matter. And they had like really tested and they really decided that white athletes and Black athletes were not on the same mental aptitude level, which was obviously so super ridiculous because, again, we are the smartest people. We are the most creative people. We're the most talented people. We are the most dopest people that live on the earth. People, listen to that and hear that clearly. Okay. We are not under anyone. Anything that's dope that was invented, it was us. Right. Okay. Yeah. Seriously.
Well, think about that for a second, right? When you go back into the slavery times, right? They have that concept because they prohibit you from learning. Mm-hmm. Because here's the thing. You just said something really profound that most people will miss. Just really think about what you said. We're the smartest, right? So if you didn't deem us to be the smartest, you would have no need to take away our ability to learn.
Right, exactly.
When you really think about that,
right?
If I don't want you to learn something, that means I didn't teach you how to read. I didn't teach you a trade. You didn't have an opportunity to have a legacy passed down to you or a business passed down to you. So if I want to, what's the word I'm looking for? If I want to lower the value of anybody, all I have to do is take away their ability to do the things that I know how to do myself, right?
Mm-hmm, right.
That way I keep them pigeonholed. I keep them in a box, so to speak, and I don't allow them to flourish and fulfill their full potential. And when you start thinking about being enslaved, it creates a mindset that has you operating with supposed limitations, because you're not limited. These are just limitations that I have told you about yourself. Like if you tell a kid he's dumb and you keep telling him he's dumb, after a while he's going to believe he's dumb. So he won't perform at optimal because he believes in his mind he's dumb. And most people down here don't realize everything that you do or don't do starts in your mind.
Right. But the trick now is one of the tricks now, because honestly, our oppressors have this whole vile, evil, misdirection. They have all those things figured out on a nuclear level. Right. And so, I think one of the biggest tricks now is the fact that they make a lot of stupid people famous. So they make our role models, the people that we see the most on TV, the most trending, the most visible, be like definitely not in our talented 10th or anything of that nature. It's definitely a bunch of idiots. And so that's the people we show on TV all the time. So now that's polluting our wells. Uh-huh. You know what I'm saying? And so if we understand and we create our children to aspire to be reality TV stars, you know what I'm saying? And things of that nature, they'll never, ever, you don't even have to put any other poison in there. Just what we see and what we hear through the music and what we see on television is just all that they needed to do to pollute the wells. Now these kids want to be Pusha T. That's who, you know, he's like a role model, Future.
These Who's people that?
Are, yeah, right, exactly.
I don't even know who that is.
Oh, Pusha T is hilarious because he's got a song where he says he can't go nowhere because he done shot up everywhere he was.
Oh my goodness. Wow.
and so he was nominated for a BT award for like new artist of the year and all kinds of stuff like that. But it's no coincidence that we see our less conscious artists have the least amount of platforms, the least amount of shine, and all of those different kinds of things. So yeah, we know what this is.
Yeah,
we know what this is because we're in media. But our 12 year old nieces and nephews and mentees and stuff, they don't have a clue. They're just like, yeah, he lit, man. He lit, bro. Bro lit. I'm trying to be bro.
we gravitate to all the trends, all the sayings. And you know, here's the thing I do, man. Especially when I'm talking to people and I hear people say certain things or do certain things, I normally try to go into, hey, why do you do that? And when you really dig into it, you'll find out people just do things because that's what everybody else is doing. That's what they're taught. But they don't even have a clue what it means or why they're doing it. It's and again, it perpetuates the system of, okay, I have you as a robot and I need you to operate in the system so that I can keep you confined.
Zombie clones is what I call them.
Zombie
clones, because you know it's like you see them, their heads are always down in their phones, you know what I'm saying, like they're have on headphones on both ears even though they're out in the world in public. You know, people like, yo, hey buddies, like, you know, your jacket is on fire, you'll never know until you feel flame on yourself, even though three people have yelled at you, but you're not paying attention, you're on fire. And that's just kind of this culture. You know, it's definitely more sheep then there are leaders. And some of that is, of course, you know, I think due to the absence of the black man in the household and all kinds of stuff, have a lot to do with that. But it's very much a blind leading the blind type of culture right now.
That's strategic. You know that.
Of course, definitely.
Like when you talk about the black man not being in the home, that is strategic. And it goes way back because think about like the mindsets of a host of black men today, especially in the younger generation. We're thinking about gangs. We're thinking about the drug business. We're thinking about how we make fast money quick, right? Because that's what we've been taught. And we do illegal things. The system is designed to capitalize on our labor as they've done since the beginning of time. So we get harsher penalties and more time than the white man gets on any given day. If y'all don't believe me, go sit in the courtroom. Just go sit in a courtroom and listen to the citizen. We're talking about people, first offense, 25 years. What you mean 25 years for my first offense?
Yeah, it's just, you know, that was just their way. That was, again, that was the part of the diabolical nature of this is how we keep slavery. Like, you know, so yeah, this is how we keep the bare bones aspect of it. We'll just make slavery be our culture and corporate America in general, but then we'll do the pennies on a dollar energy, you know what I'm saying, through the prison system where we unfairly target, stereotype, and do all of those kinds of things through a police system where the police were literally designed to hunt slaves.
Yes.
So that's a lot going on here, man.
All right. So do you think people are aspiring in today's in 2021 to be or become a Renaissance man or woman?
No, I don't think so. I think that we are at this point really kind of pigeonholed into trades and into a more monolithic expression of life. I did an interview a while back on a TV show called Soundbar Live TV. And I talked about the fact that I think that us as African Americans, by and large, are operating at about 40% of our true capacity because we are capable of so much more than what this country will teach us or show us or even really create space or allow us to do. I think that people aren't aspiring to be Renaissance people because that's looked at as you got too much going on. You're all over the place. You need to focus on one thing. You need to focus on one thing. And when you think about focusing on one thing, who did that? Like our ancestors, that's really what slavery was. It was a focus on one thing. You pick cotton, you're a blacksmith, you're a house nigga, you're this thing. And anything outside of that you are doing is going to come with negative connotations and potentially impacts and outcomes. And so we are still teaching that to our kids. We're teaching them to find a trade, find something to do. But when we talked about the purpose algorithm a while back, it was just about helping others with your unique gifts, skills, and abilities. And that in itself creates space for a Renaissance person to be impactful. Mm-hmm. Okay, because when I look at myself and I look at my life, I wasn't on a quest to be a Renaissance man. I'm just from a family of singers, preachers, doctors, civil rights activists. So that was my lineage. But then my father, being a Q Mason, a funeral director, a life insurance guy, he had his own radio show, owned several properties and those kinds of things. And he played tennis in college. My parents met in college. So it was never like I never saw a simple person. You know what I'm saying? And so I think that they want us to be really simple because that's where they can control us. Okay. If we don't aspire to utilize our gifts and to channel our passions into productivity in a way that's beneficial to us, our families, our wholeness, and those kinds of things, we'll never unlock what it means to even pursue wealth.
You trying to have them folk on your ass, ain't you?
Look, it'll be clean. You know what I'm saying? No, it's just a reality though, Finch. Like I've talked to kids, I'm talking to students in all the different age groups. And when I talk to the college students, they, you know, they'll sit down with me and when I ask a question, I've had this question asked so many times and it's such an eye rolling question. The question is, you know, they've come up and they're so passionate and it's like, so Mr. Dickey, I see everything you're doing and I'm at a place in my life where I'm trying to make a decision. And it's like, I'm trying to decide, should I be an artist or an entrepreneur? And I'm thinking an artist or an entrepreneur. I'm like, why do you think you have to pick between those two? Like, you know, what makes you think you're probably not going to be all of those two things at the same time,
right?
Regardless. You know what I'm saying? Like you have to keep an entrepreneurial mind as an artist because at the end of the day, what's being sold is you. Okay. It's your likeness in whatever way that is. So it's like the fact that they think they're making a decision and that they have to choose. And it's this exhausting process of my purpose and, you know, what path I'm going to pick. No, do all of the stuff. Anything that you feel and anything at 12 years old that you wanted to do, you should be doing those things when you're 80 years old also. Okay. And if you're not doing those things because you aren't physically able, you have to be creating a path for other people to do those things.
People are probably listening or watching this and saying, what the fuck is he talking about? I know what he's talking about. You got to think about this for a second, Daniel. You just said back in the slave days, you was told or taught to do just one thing.
Right.
So let's bring that forward. The person that asked you the question about whether or not they should be an artist or entrepreneur have been taught that mindset that, hey, wait a minute, being an artist isn't being an entrepreneur. And that's, I'm going to say this, I'm going to have the folk on my ass, but I don't care. So that's what the industry teaches you as an artist. Just focus on being an artist because they don't want you to be an entrepreneur. Because when you become an entrepreneur, you realize just how much they fucking you and you realize how much you don't really need them to do a lot of the things that you actually want to do.
Yeah. But when you look now, Finch, though, the deals are a 360 that covers all of your endeavors. Anything you decide to do later, that's going to be also covered in that deal.
But then, you know, see, this is the thing that I want young people to understand. In today's time, you got to think, like, let's go back. When me and you did the BET Style Suite in Atlanta, Georgia, 12, 13 years ago, however long it was.
Man.
Social media had not taken off yet. It was just getting started, really just getting in the groove.
Mm-hmm.
And nowadays, as an artist, as a painter, as a podcaster, whatever it is you want to do, you don't necessarily need the engine to do those things. Why do you think so many people lean towards, I got to get a record deal by this company, or I got to get signed by this one, I got to get recognized by this person of influence or this celebrity in order for me to do stuff? Because I think that goes back to what you said earlier about the mindsets of the people.
I mean, I think one of the things that I think we're in a place though, Finch, where a lot of times I know in Black America, words of affirmation as a love language is not necessarily one that, you know, our dads rarely brought that to the table. And true. And maybe our moms did, maybe they didn't. But you know, just in any level of validation in your gifts and your skills and your abilities is something that people really need to thrive because, you know, a lot of times we don't have good words to say to each other. You know, people will jump in line to tell you how they got you fucked up, how you got me all the way fucked up. Look, But look, won't remind you of how you stepped up. Won't remind you of how you showed up. Won't remind you of how you pulled up when nobody else did. And so I think that's why we seek that validation, because we didn't usually get it in our homes. Uh-huh. You know what I'm saying? You know, we have our teachers obviously teaching us lies. You know what I'm saying? Lots of times. So, you know, they aren't bringing a lot of affirmation. So I think that having someone that they think is on or they think is popping, agree and feel like they're popping, brings a certain level of value to people. I'm one of those people who I don't get high off the praise and I don't get low off the naysaying. I'm a very level person because I'm always just riding my own wave. You know what I'm saying? Like at this point, I know my gifts, I know my skills, I know my abilities, I know my purpose, I know my passions, and I really only really operate in them. Like, you know, like being able to own an agency where we don't pursue business, we don't do RFPs, we're not looking for clients, and the business just flows. It flows word of mouth, it flows by reputation. I don't even be knowing the people. And sometimes when a person tells me who referred them, I won't even know the person who they said referred me. Right. You know what I'm saying? And so I think that in itself is like a testament to what it means to really be on a vibration to where you're attracting your soul and your spirit and your energy aligns with you enough to attract the blessings and to attract the flow of money and to attract the flow of wealth. And so I don't think that our oppressors don't want us to know what it means to be Renaissance people, because they don't want us to know what it means to be whole. They want us to be these fractioned, marginalized, you know, cookie cutter, tiny box versions of our huge, amazing, extraordinary, innovative selves.
So true, man. So true. And we talked about, you know, a lot about what you do, what you've done. But I wanted to ask, how did you discover, or what would you attribute to you discovering? You talk about your purpose, you talk about riding your own wave. That takes a certain level of confidence. Where did that come from for you?
Well, I mean, it comes from a couple of places. One is my lineage. Like, I'm named after my two grandfathers. Okay. And so Daniel is Dr. Daniel Carter Roan. And he has passed away, RIP, but he was one of the first Black doctors in Wilmington, North Carolina, where I'm from. Okay. He was the co-plaintiff in the litigation that integrated the hospitals in Wilmington and integrated the school system in Wilmington. And he was also one of the doctors who nurtured the tennis career of Althea Gibson. And so he has his name on buildings. Mm-hmm. And so then my middle name came from my mom's dad, who is still alive, and he is the second longest tenured reverend in the history of the First Missionary Baptist Church. And so he's got letters and honorary doctorates from several schools, letters from presidents. And so I'm the namesake of these two extraordinary men. And so I think a part of it comes from knowing that anointing flows through me. And so then for me now, just looking back, you know, just thinking about all of my interactions with leadership. And I remember being a kid, Finch, 12, 13, 11 years old, and my teachers would be telling my parents that I was in control of their classrooms. And so, yeah, I'm like, okay, I'm just this little kid. How are you saying I'm in control of anything? And you're saying it like it's a bad thing. And so they were saying that if I was behaving, then the whole class would be behaving. But if I was misbehaving, the whole class would be misbehaving and off task. And I guess looking back, that was my first real interaction with what it means to be a charismatic leader and to be someone who, you know, because to me, I was just doing my work faster than everyone and then throwing spitballs at them. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't like, oh, I'm going to lead or anything. But it was natural born leadership. And I think there's confidence that comes from that. Mm-hmm. And I think some of the confidence comes from being a Renaissance man. There are very few things that we can talk about, you know what I'm saying, that I haven't been exposed to in some way or another. And so now for me, it's a desire versus ability, because I know how to do lots of stuff. Do I desire to do those things? Right. Not a lot, but I have a level of confidence. I know what this is supposed to look like. I know how this is supposed to feel. I know how the song is supposed to be sung. I know how the campaign is supposed to be ran. Mm-hmm. I know those things. And so that confidence comes from that, really, from knowing. You know what I'm saying? Not searching, not, but from a knowing. Like, I know that I am proficient and well-rounded and educated and cultured and knowledgeable across lots of different divides.
What would you say to individuals who are at a point in life, because, you know, the last year has been a tumultuous year for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. You know, you still got millions of people across the country who are out of work, who are dependent on unemployment. As the world has opened back up and people are looking at life, let's go back to being normal, not really realizing life will never be as normal as we had seen it as before. But they are on the fence, so to speak.
Okay.
Where do I go? Like, how do I like, I hear this guy, I see this girl, and they have a whole thing. Because most times people think somebody has something that they don't have. And they are literally sitting on the fence in fear, riddled with frustration, and they have no clue on how to move forward. As a Renaissance man, what would you say to those people to get them off that fence?
Well, for me, one of the things that I never lost, and I think it's become a tactical advantage, mm-hmm. is I never lost my connection with the 12-year-old version of me. I didn't let life pile up a bunch of shit on top of me, a bunch of expectations that weren't mine or my people's mm-hmm. or my passion or my purpose or my destiny or any of those things. I didn't let people pile all that shit on me. You know what I'm saying? I was definitely that kid who was, I was the Matrix. Piling a bunch of shit on me. And so I think that's the first thing, is I think a lot of times people have to get unstuck. Okay, we are supposed to be active. We are supposed to be moving. We are supposed to be kinetic energy. Okay, and so God is typically going to bless you on your go. Okay, like it's not you sitting around waiting. It is me. You should move. I think you should always move in the directions of things that you feel capable, mm-hmm. passionate, and purpose to do. And I think if you are put yourself on that path, then God will meet you there, and He will take you to where you need to go. I think that would be the first thing. I think this is a great time to learn a new skill or to hone an ability that you have that's laid dormant inside you from that 12-year-old version of you. Mm-hmm. And those kinds of things. I think also they can schedule a consultation with me, Finch. I definitely can get people off of a fence. You know, and look, I can get people off of a fence, and my agency, we're a 360 agency. So we help people literally take their vision and dreams from expectation to manifestation, from setting up businesses to nonprofits to websites and all of those different kinds of things. But then also getting internships, you know what I'm saying? Going and maybe taking that pay cut and learning how to do something you really wanted to do your whole life. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's just, imagine all the you know, when you look at some of these passions, and excuse me, when we look at some of these careers that we get drawn into, mm-hmm. when you look at what it means to be a lawyer, or when you look at what it means to be a doctor, those are like some of the drunkest people off of work in the history of like they are drinking the most alcohol ever. Like, you know what I'm saying? And so they're drowning away their sorrows a lot of times because they make all this money and all of that. And, you know, they've remembered all these big ass books and all of those kinds of things, but they really wanted to be a saxophone player. And they're too busy to play the sax in their head and in their heart and in their life. And so I think that find a way to do anything that you ever wanted to do. You should find a way to do those things. And even if you don't make money, and this is the part that is another trap for us, because we think that everything that we do has to make money.
Well, we got to pay bills, Daniel.
Yeah, you do. And you should figure out a way to do that. But everything that you do, you're not going to be able to monetize. And then your desire to monetize everything is the reason why you don't do almost anything.
Spread the word by leaving a rating and review on iTunes.
Thanks for joining us, where it always feels good.